So we're going to have Yimu Bao from UC Berkeley. He's going to tell us about finite-time teleportation fidelity, phase transition in unitary circuits. Thank you, Yimu.
Thanks to Hugo for introduction, and thanks to the organizer for putting together an in-person workshop. I know everyone is tired, but you have to listen to me this time. It's not like a Zoom call. You can turn off your camera and lie on the bed. Sorry, that's not allowed today. Okay. Today, I changed my title a little bit. Today, I'm going to talk about a recent unpublished work. Hopefully, we can put it on archive very soon. So I'm going to talk about finite-time teleportation fidelity phase transition in unitary circuit. And this work is done with Max in the audience and also Ahud. So recent year, we have seen a huge progress in developing near-term quantum device like superconducting qubits, Rydberg atom array, trapped ion, and other platforms. And these platforms provide a new paradigm for us to study quantum many-body physics. They can simulate the dynamics of 50 to 200 qubits, and under the evolution of unitary gaze local measurement, and due to the imperfection of the platform, they also involve some decoherence in the circuit. And one can ask, what are the interesting quantum information dynamics that one can achieve in such platforms? For example, it has been already demonstrated in the quantum gas microscope that one can study the generic entanglement growth and saturation in a small system, and one can really see the linear growth and saturation of entanglement. And today I'm going to talk about a particular type of many-body dynamics called quantum circuit dynamics, and this quantum circuit can capture the generic feature of the information dynamics in a many-body circuit, such as many-body systems, such as the entanglement growth and operators spreading, and so on. And another benefit of studying this kind of dynamics is because it's simple and analytically trackable. So one motivation of our study, the main result I'm going to talk about today is coming from a technique that people develop when study this random circuit. So first of all, when people study the entanglement dynamics of RUC, people develop a really nice mapping to STEMAC model. And let me just briefly walk through a little bit detail of this technique. So say we want to study the entanglement of a subsystem A, in a random circuit made of this two-qubit hard random unitary gate arranged in a brick layer structure, and we want to study what is the entanglement entropy of subsystem A as a function of time. For now, let's look at the Rényi 2 entanglement entropy, which can be written as the second moment of the density matrix rho A, and the dynamics of this Rényi 2 entropy can be written as the following form. We consider the dynamics of two copies of density matrix, and which can be written in the tensor network diagram here. You consider copy 1, cat and bra, copy 2, cat and bra, evolve under this random circuit evolution. And after that, you trace over subsystem B, and you obtain the reduced density matrix rho A for each copies of density matrix. And then you compute the second moment of the density matrix, which can give you the entanglement, Rényi 2 entanglement entropy. One way to put that, to write it down, is to write it down as such a tensor network diagram where we have the brick layer structure representing the time evolution of two copies of density matrix, and computing the entanglement entropy reduces to contracting the tensor network at the top with basically tracing over subsystem B while swap the subsystem A and then compute the second moment. So that results in a different, you can say, different boundary condition or different contraction of subsystem A and B at the top of this tensor network. And the value of this tensor network will give you the second moment of density matrix. And there's a really nice mapping. People understand how to compute a entanglement dynamics in a quantum system by reducing it to some calculation in a classical classical static model. The way people do that is we can perform the averaging over unitary gates. Here, because we are considering two copies of density matrix that involves four copies of unitary evolution, both Keter and Bra for copy one and Keter and Bra for copy two. And the averaging of unitary gate will result in a classical sum over a few terms that can be labeled by classical spin degrees of freedom. I hear the spin degrees of freedom correspond to the different way of contracting four legs. Either you contract it as here, basically contracting the cat and bra within the same copy, or cat and bra from the different copy. I call this contraction spin up and this contraction spin down. And the Renyi entropy calculation, which is the something we want to study in a many-body system, reduces to the free energy cost of pinning a domain wall at the top of such a 1 plus 1D classical spin model. So basically, we replace each tensor here by a summation over spin degrees of freedom living locally in a 1 plus 1D geometry. And the Renyi entropy corresponds to a free energy cost of pinning a domain wall at the top boundary, basically forcing subsystem A choosing spin down, subsystem B choosing spin up. Okay, and sorry about the bringing up this a lot of technology at the beginning, but okay. And what is important here is we notice that in this tensor network diagram, there is a very nice symmetry in the tensor network for representing the Renyi 2 entropy, which is we call it permutation symmetry S2. This can be easily seen from the network level, where we have UU dagger. So the tensor network is invariant under the permutation of two copies of cat or two copies of bra. So there's a Z2 permutation symmetry here. And in the static model, it turns out there's a very nicely we can understand, as I said, as entanglement entropy is the free energy cost of a domain wall. And in such a spin model with Z2 symmetry, you can expect there exist two phases, either the ferromagnetic phase where you have this S2 symmetry breaking, or you have the symmetric phase, the S2 symmetry is unbroken. That it turns out this, if you have a symmetry breaking in the bulk, you can show the free energy cost of a domain wall, enforcing a domain wall, were proportional to the subsystem size, that will lead to a volume law entropy. And if the symmetry is unbroken, it will give you area law entanglement entropy. In the case we consider, which is a purely unitary evolution, one can show that you always have a symmetry breaking bulk, which will give rise to the volume law entanglement entropy at a long time. But I want to brought up this symmetry because that will be very important for the talk later on. Okay. And okay, what really motivates this work is earlier this year we wrote a paper about how to understand this this 1 plus 1D classical static problem. So it turns out one can do this is a textbook thing. One can do the classical to quantum mapping to understand a 1 plus 1D classical static model as a 1D quantum ground state problem. Basically, just map it to a quantum problem, and here we can formulate this dynamics of two copies of density matrix as a dynamics under an effective quantum Hamiltonian, and the time, which is the temporal direction in this classical static model. Once you take the time go to infinity, basically infinitely deep circuit, then you got a truly 1 plus 1D classical model, and we can show that you can use a state to represent the dynamics of two copies, state evolution to represent the dynamics of two copies of density matrix, and this quantum state rho 2 will evolve to the ground state of H effective. So this is what is previously known, and now the question that drives us to the result I'm talking about today is. As I show here, you can map the dynamics of a random circuit to an imaginary time evolution generated by a quantum Hamiltonian. And then we can ask what, but previously we studied a case of a deep circuit where you take the limit time goes to infinity. Now you can ask a question, what happened at finite times? Then finite time will correspond to the case you do an imaginary time evolution of a quantum Hamiltonian, but of a finite finite imaginary time, and that we immediately know this would correspond to the partition function of a quantum Hamiltonian at finite temperature. And this talk I'm going to tell you, and this will actually lead to a surprising prediction that one can have a finite time teleportation fidelity phase transition in a unitary circuit. So first of all, let me just specify what is the circuit I'm considering. I'm considering a purely unitary circuit made of 2-qubit Hall random gates, and there's a distribution of the range of 2-qubit Hall random gate. They can acting on 2 qubits I and j with a distance x, distance x is drawn from a certain probability distribution. I will specify later on, but for now, just say you have an arbitrary distribution of 2-qubit Hall random gate, and we can map this the dynamics of 2 copies of density matrix under this evolution to an imaginary time evolution of a quantum Hamiltonian H-effective. And this H-effective will take the following form. It's basically a quantum IC model with a transverse field along the x direction. And we also know this Hamiltonian has a Z2 symmetry generated by the product of sigma x at every site. So this is exactly the S2 symmetry I talked about previously. And yes?
So on the right hand side, you have a time t, right? The frequency is fixed, and then you have a time t.
Yes.
And on the left hand side?
We have a finite depth circuit, so the depth of the circuit is t. Hamiltonian is determined by the distribution of gate on the left.
So jij is
given by the distribution of 2-qubit gate. If you fix the distribution of 2-qubit gate to be the same at a different time, then jij is independent of time. Depends on space. It can depend on space. I'll specify what is the dependence on space later on. But for now, let's just keep it general. So it comes from the distribution of 2-qubit gate. Can in principle depend on space. You can make it translational invariant. Yes. But the mapping is general. It's for even true for translational. Translationally variant system, yeah.
On the left is unitary, and on the right is not.
Yes, on the left is unitary, but on the right is talking about the dynamics of two copies of density matrix, and then you average over the randomness in the circuit. The averaging loses the information, so makes it a imaginary time evolution. It's determined by the distribution of 2-qubit gates. Once you fix that distribution, Jij is determined. Okay, in a finite temperature problem for such a effective Hamiltonian, basically a transverse field IC model, we can imagine in certain cases it can exhibit a finite temperature phase transition that breaks the S2. And this can happen if you have short-range interaction, basically assuming Jij is short-range, then this transition can happen in 2D or higher dimensional systems. Or if you have a long-range interaction in Jij, and this can even happen in one dimension. So now I just show you there's a possibility that there exists a phase transition at finite time. But what are the physical implications? I haven't tell you how to observe a finite time transition. What is the observable of this transition? So naively, the first try is let's try the entanglement entropy. But immediately you realize this will not work, because for the entanglement entropy, we know the entanglement entropy just grow linearly and then saturate to a finite value. There's no singularity at finite time. It just grows linearly. And we also have an understanding of this, why this is not true. This is because, as I told you before, computing entanglement entropy reduces to the free energy of enforcing a domain wall at the top boundary. So here, what we are doing is we consider a finite slab of a classical model. You no longer have 1 plus 1d because the time direction is finite. So you have a finite slab, and you enforce a symmetry breaking boundary condition at the top. And this symmetry breaking boundary condition, it's a magnetic field acting on the extensive number of spins, so that will explicitly break this S2 symmetry. So there won't be any phase transition in the entanglement entropy due to this boundary condition. Yes, so there's no phase transition. And what quantity will exhibit phase transition? There is actually such a quantity which is the teleportation fidelity. The setup is the following. We prepare the qubits, n qubit system with n minus 1 qubit in the zero state and 1 qubit and encode some quantum information in one of the qubits, say the leftmost qubit. And then you evolve it by some unitary circuit for finite time t. And after that, we do a measurement on n minus 1 qubit and leave 1 qubit unmeasured. We call it output qubit. And then we ask, what is the mutual information between this input and output qubit? Basically, how that serves as an upper bound, how much information you can teleportate from the input qubit on the left to the right to the output qubit on the right. And because there's a measurement, so no longer need to respect this Lieb-Robinson bound, because the evolution itself, evolution is no longer unitary because you have measurement at the top. I'm going to show you in a second. Actually, this will allow a teleportation fidelity phase transition that when this time t is above a certain value, the input qubit can teleportate the information to an output qubit that is infinitely far away from each other.
What restrictions do you have in the gates you use in the middle?
That shouldn't matter, but we believe this will work for, what is the restriction? The geometry, the dimensionality, and the long-rangeness of the gates matter, but the detail, the microscopic detail of the gates, we believe it does not matter. And for this talk, I'm just assuming they are hard random gates for simplicity. Here measurement. I mean, after you do the measurement, you project it onto a certain measurement outcome. So you need to know the measurement outcome. So in another word, I'm considering the mutual information conditioned on the measurement outcome. You cannot just throw the measurement outcome away. That would reduce us to just computing the mutual information. You will see nothing interesting. Okay, and this protocol will translate to something makes sense in this stemac picture. Previously, for the computing entanglement entropy, we have symmetry breaking boundary condition at the top, but here, actually, one can show that if you measure the qubits at the top, that will enforce an open boundary condition. So no longer symmetry breaking field at the top. So in this case, you have a finite slab. And it will allow an ordering transition that breaks this S2, provided you have a 2D or higher dimensional geometry. And this transition will be seen in this teleportation fidelity. I'll show you in a second. Okay, and this teleportation fidelity in the classical stemac model will reduce us to Well, it reduces to the spin-spin correlation function. One spin living at the time zero on site A, and another spin living at time t on site B. And this circuit will exhibit two phases, when you tune time. So previously we know this time appears in this partition function as the inverse temperature. So the longer time means lower temperature. We understand that in a quantizing model at finite temperature, you can have a paramagnetic phase at high temperature and a ferromagnetic phase at low temperature. That would translate into the temperature means 1 over time, so that will translate into paramagnetic phase at short time and the ferromagnetic phase at long time. And as I tell you, this conditional mutual information between A and B becomes the spin-spin correlation function. So in the ferromagnetic phase, even if A and B are infinitely far away from each other, this spin-spin correlation function will approaches this magnetization square, which will achieve a finite but non-vanishing value. That tells you you can teleportate the information between A and B, even if A and B are infinitely far away from each other. And in the paramagnetic phase, when T is less than TC, which is of an order one value, this mutual information will just decay exponentially as a function, with the distance between A and B. And in the circuit, we can also understand this actually makes sense. It reminds us of this measurement-based quantum computation. So paradigmatic example in the MBQC, which is you have a 2D cluster state and you measure, you perform measurement on in the XY plane, and that measurement can help you transfer the entanglement from one end to the other and correlate this input qubit A and output qubit B. Similar phenomena has been proposed in 2D random circuit by Knapp et al. In a paper earlier last year. Yes, so now I'm going to show you some Clifford numerical simulation that demonstrates such a phenomenon. So first example I'm going to talk about is 1D circuit with 1 over x to the alpha interaction. So this 1 over x alpha interaction will specify Jij that you guys previously asked about. So in this circuit with 1 over x alpha interaction, I assume the range x of this 2-qubit hard random gate is drawn from a distribution that decays as a power law, with power law coefficient alpha. And this will result in effective Hamiltonian with Jij behaves like J over I minus J to the power alpha. The finite temperature phase transition in such a model is actually well studied. It also reminds us of a spin boson problem. You couple a spin to a bosonic bath, it depends on whether the bath is ohmic or subohmic or superohmic. You can either have transition or not no transition. And it's pretty clear that in this model, people understand there exists a finite temperature phase transition for alpha less or equal than 2. And what is even more is that we understand that the transition is mean field transition when alpha less than 1.5. And the transition is actually a KT transition at alpha equals 2. These are all the results from this STEMAC mapping and the understanding of finite temperature transition in H effective. And this will be a proposed phase diagram for this effective Hamiltonian. The y-axis you can understand as the temperature, and the x-axis is the power law coefficient. One can do an exact mean field study for the case of alpha equals 0, and you can find the phase transition in the magnetization with a mean field exponent beta equals 0.5 and nu equals 2. Okay, now there's no transition. You will see what it looks like just in a second. So now we perform the Clifford simulation on such a circuit. On the previous slide, so these are all the predictions from the effective Hamiltonian. So now I'm going to examine it using this Clifford simulation. And one can see, I'm now presenting three panels. So from the left to the right, we have alpha equals 0, alpha equals 1.75, and alpha equals 3. According to our theory, you will have mean field transition for alpha equals 0 and non-mean field transition for alpha equals 1.75. And there's no transition for alpha equals 3. And we exactly see that's the case. So for alpha equals 0, we have so different curves are representing different system size. And we can extract the exponent beta equals 0.46 and nu equals 2. And for 1.75, we can see beta clearly deviate from the from the mean field exponent. And for alpha equals 3, there's no phase transition. And here is a phase diagram that we obtained from this Clifford numerical simulation. And we see this is the critical exponent nu and beta as a function of alpha. We clearly see there's a change of universality when alpha greater than 1.5. Okay, and second example I'm going to tell you is about two D random unitary circuit. And in this case, the Jij is drawn from a different distribution. And because I arranged this hard random case in a brick layer 2D structure, and there's only non-vanishing coupling Jij between nearest neighbor ij. And the effective Hamiltonian will reduce this to this form. Everything in the square bracket is still the same. It's transverse field Ising. And there is a previous work by Knapp has showed that this they look at a different quantity, but they show this transition. The transition is essentially the same. They show this transition can be mapped to like 1D hybrid dynamics involving unitary and measurement, so-called measurement-induced transition that Greg talked about this morning. We performed a simulation for this conditional mutual information IAB, and we show indeed, there is a transition also in 2D, and the exponent actually agrees with the exponent in 1D measurement-induced phase transition. Okay, so now I want to, how many time do I have?
I have like 3 minutes or something.
Okay, then yeah, it's fine. Okay, now let me summarize what I have told you today. So today I tell you there exists a finite time teleportation fidelity phase transition in unitary circuits, and this transition can be mapped to the finite temperature ordering phase transition. I provide examples of this in 1D long range and 2D short range system, and there are a few future directions based on this. One is whether one can connect this transition to the sampling complexity in the output state. What we believe is this is a conjecture that we haven't fully proved, but we believe it is true. And in 1D brick layer circuit, we believe the sampling complexity from a finite depth 1D short range circuit should be easy. And it only becomes hard when the depth of circuit is of the order system size. And in 2D, that's not the case. We believe even sampling from a finite depth 2D circuit is already hard. And what we believe currently is our transition can be related to this. A second future direction is now I tell you that one can develop a long-range entanglement between A and B by measuring the rest of the qubit. However, I only demonstrate they are entangled. I didn't tell you which basis they are entangled in. And to figure out the basis they are entangled in, this requires a decoding algorithm to really sort it out. And whether one can construct it explicitly, that's another question. It's like constructing a decoding circuit for Hayden-Preskill protocol. Here is slightly different because you evolve a finite time and you do measurements. So, okay. Some other question also involves whether one can experimentally realize this or not. But what we currently believe you either need a decoding algorithm or you need to do post selection on the exponentially many measurement results. Okay, I think I'm going to wrap it up here. Okay, according to the previous plan, I was going to talk about another work, but I think I don't have time. But this is a very interesting work in collaboration with Zach and others. And Zach is also in the audience, so if you are interested in that, you can talk to Zach. It's about a measurement-induced negativity phase transition. Yep. So any question? Yeah.
Just having product states all in zero. Like if we change it a bit, especially like make it more entangled between those qubits that are of long distance to each other. Like how will the results be different?
You mean the qubits are just locally entangled, is that right?
So you go back to the slide.
Yes. Okay, if you prepare a different initial state, that qubits are, let's say, the Bell pair in every two qubits. Is that the question, or?
Yeah, that's one possibility. I'm just curious about like more general initial states, because here this is like a quite special initial condition.
Yes.
What if like the first qubit and the last qubit, they are maximally entangled, and in the middle, they are also entangled here and there in a weird way?
Yes. I'm also considering non-local circuit, so you can have all-to-all interaction. That's the alpha equals zero case.
Okay, yeah, sure. I just want to know, like, in general.
Yes. Okay, the guiding principle is we ask whether the initial state breaks this S2 symmetry or not. So the requirement of having such a phase transition is the both the initial condition at the bottom and the initial condition as a boundary condition at the bottom and top. All of them don't break the symmetry. So if you only have the short range, it'll have an initial state with short range entanglement. That won't change the picture at all. So it's still a symmetry preserving boundary condition, and you will see the phase transition.
But if you have longer range pairs, it still preserves the symmetry, but it may change the
behavior. Yes, if you have longer pair, my understanding is that will be. That will be on every in total it respects the symmetry, but it but locally they are breaking the symmetry. So maybe I can answer the first question. If you have a long-range entanglement, I think that will be equivalent to the following thing. You have a unitary circuit already before your initial state. So that will enforce a ferromagnetic coupling between two spins that are long-range entangled. So that will not kill the phase transition. For the second question, could you remind me of Yes.
But it may change where is the phase transition.
Yes.
It's like you change the range of coupling, but you add a long range coupling.
I agree. Yeah.
But let's say the last qubit, I think it's kind of special compared with the rest, like say the second last qubit.
Uh-huh.
So if I make, like I engineer a weird initial state that really emphasizes on the special property of the last qubit, compared to engineering
Am I going to expect very different behaviors? I agree. The last qubit is different from the rest, because if you compute the mutual information between the initial state of last and the final state of the last qubit, you will expect it cannot be very small. But I don't know how whether you can see anything interesting from there or not. I agree, it's different. Yeah. Yes. Yes.
Can I see that in effective Hamiltonian in some way, or does that not enter?
Good question. Um, Let me think. So the reason I'm hesitating is the following. So in order to see the causality, you need to compute some observable in your unitary circuit. And any observable translate into the stepmagnetic picture is a symmetry breaking boundary condition at the top. So to really see the causality, you might not be able to just see the causality from the effective Hamiltonian. You need to take into account the boundary condition, I think. Yes. Right.
Any other questions?
Before we thank the speakers again, I'd like to thank a few people. First of all, thanks to all of you for coming, especially the out-of-towners, and especially some who came from really far away.